The title of this talk is Interaction and Dialogue with Large-Scale Textual Data, and it's about the focus, the substantial focus is about the speeches about migration, the speeches given by migrants, as I will explain. Let me jump right into what I want to talk about, the dialectics of Angela Merkel. Now, there are many sides of Angela Merkel, and you have maybe seen this picture. The Iron Lady of Europe, with the speaker helmet. Earlier this year, in June and July, it seemed as if everybody in Europe was angry about Germany and Angela Merkel because of its tough stance on Greece. And this is part of the German reports on Angela Merkel's policy, the Iron Lady, please be tough on Greece. And if you want to have the international perception, the new statements considered Angela Merkel as Europe's most dangerous leader. Now, that appears to have changed. Recently, the Spiegel, Angela is like Mother Angela Merkel, she's the new Mother Teresa in European politics because of her open stance towards welcoming refugees in Germany. Now, that seems to be very odd, this quick change. To put it on a more general level, to turn it into statements about the German polity, there is an old debate about what I would call salad bowl multiculturalism. Salad bowl because in a salad, every ingredient will stay, well, as it is. It will be a chunk in the salad. And as a concept for a multicultural society, it would mean that people that are a group within a larger society may maintain their culture, be it Islamic, Buddhist, Christian, whatsoever. Now, that's an old perception. Angela Merkel said multiculturalism has failed, utterly failed. That statement in 2011 was perceived very critically in Europe, and many thought that she would want to return to an old style of German nationalism. But now look at this. We find many pictures of Angela Merkel and other politicians cutting döners. So this is Angela Merkel, good luck. But you would also find people from the Green Party or from the Social Democrats symbolically eating donuts. Now, that's, of course, a marketing instrument to address new target groups. But it's also kind of the deep structure of the welcoming stance of Germany towards refugees these days. It seems as if the old nationalism, the old perception that Germany needs to be closed, needs to stay a homogeneous society, as if that had been overcome. But the question I want to ask is, how robust is what we're seeing? It's called Willkommenskultur, welcoming culture, but how robust would that be? The theoretical assumption I make is, it's a matter of the institutionalization of the perception of nationship and citizenship. That means that if there has been a change in the conception of nationhood and citizenship we have, if there has been a change towards a more multicultural stance, then it might be robust even if we see up to 1 million immigrants and refugees in Germany these days. Now, the different analytical approaches I want to undertake is, I want to look at the advent of diversity in public debate, because the hypothesis I pursue is that the cornerstone of what we're seeing is the change towards seeing ourselves as a diverse society. Diversity, Vielfalt, is the core concept, crucial to understand what is happening. I will analyze the context of diversity and the representation of diversity in discourse. And for that, I'll have a little surprise, a box with things. Now, just a first quick impression. Vielfalt, that's the German word for diversity. You have a Charter of Vielfalt, that's a document signed by many companies agreeing and committing themselves to support diversity within their structures, to be welcoming to different cultures. But then you have a label of the Green Party, in love with diversity. That's the Green Party, okay, that's not a surprise. Then you have the Social Democrats, a group, Migration and Vielfalt, the Liberal Party, and the CDU, which was more restrictive towards immigration in good old days. So Vielfalt is something you you see all the time. I want to glance behind that in the talk I want to give. But first of all, I like the mountains, so this is a recurring theme. The purpose. So what is the research I pursue about? Now, a few theoretical conceptual ideas. Usually I try to explain a research agenda by considering three elements of a research agenda. The research object, we have in mind the theory and the methods that we use. The research object, what inspired me finally to move to methods of e-humanities was migration and integration policy were considered a cross-cutting policy for a long time. That means it's a policy issue that needs to be considered in every other policy domain too, be it in education, consumer protection, managing the labor market, domestic security, media policy, whatsoever. That's a cross-cutting issue, but hasn't become a sectoralized policy, a policy domain of itself with a set of actors, a set of laws, a set of institutions. That's the substantial research question that has inspired my research. I was looking to develop a theory of policy fields and to see whether configurations of policy fields change, whether we see that move from a cross-cutting policy domain towards a more sectoralized policy, a proper policy field. But I found that really, really difficult, because to understand that change, I wanted to look at discourse. I needed to understand the meanings that actors make about what integration, what migration is about. But for that purpose, I needed to look at many texts, because if a policy is cross-cutting, pops up everywhere, then you need to look at labor policy, immigration policy, education policy, media policy, whatsoever. How do you do that? That's a lot of text to work with. So I had my digital awakening in 2011. And I thought that using corpora for discursive policy analysis might be extremely useful for what I was trying to accomplish. So what happens? I have my old C64, some of you might have had that too, and I thought, well, I need to move to a proper new computer, something with a printer, with tape units, and a punch card reader. Of course, this is a really bad joke, it's not really progress, but when looking at the things that we can do with computers and texts, I came across a good old book from 1966 called The General Inquirer. And Harold Glasswell, in the preface to that book, wrote, that's a long quote, I know, but he wrote, "The emergence of the computer has made it feasible for social and behavioral scientists to make a fresh start on content analysis. The vast potentialities of content analysis, though foreseen for some years, 1966, have been poorly realized, owing chiefly to the onerous task of scanning text and processing data." Okay, we know that. The latter operation, data processing, has been successfully improved, and there is the promise of automatic scanners that, when appropriately joined with panels of human judges, will accelerate the turning of raw records in data. Harold Glasswell, 1966. Now, that quote still fascinates me, because it's, well, about 50 years ago or more. What is so interesting about this book? Well, the onerous task of scanning text and processing data, the turning of raw records into data, okay, it's a lot of work. And I think everybody in this room knows that. It's maybe a bit better than in 1966. But then what we do, we have a fresh start on content analysis. Now, in the social sciences, when we talk about text mining and e-humanities, that's something we forget at times. There's a long tradition of content analysis with a lot of experience how to extract meaning from masses of text. We forget about that. And then we have a third element here. It's the panels of human judges. There's a great temptation to use the computer to substitute our minds. And you see published work that does it. But he stresses we still need human judges. And that's one of the core arguments I want to make, that even if we have wonderful text processing techniques, we still need human judgment. Maybe that's not that interesting or relevant for the non-social scientists in this room, but for social scientists, it's good not to forget about that. Now, thinking about data, of course, this is a Google server farm. There's a lot of data that we have, mostly in private hands. That's something I became concerned about. The largest bulk of data is in the hands of private companies. Well, what about the public libraries that we have? What about the public libraries of digitized text? MT, a pretty nice spelling, but MT, it needs to be filled. And that's something I really struggled about. I had this, well, project, this purpose in mind, that I want to explore cross-cutting issues with the use of computers, maybe read text from time to time, but what about the data? We have private data that are very accessible, and public data that are, at least in my domain, not as accessible as private data. And this is a big challenge, I think. Well, there is the private data, what you find, or the crawling you can do from Facebook, Twitter, from the web, from kind of Wikipedia. You will get a lot of data when you know about the art and science of web scraping. You get a lot of data very easily, and you can do fancy stuff with that. We have seen, I think, many visualizations that are really nice to look at. So that's cool in a way, but the drawback is the access to the data can be much more restrictive than it is at first sight. Do you gain access to the whole load of Facebook data? Now that's not easy. It's part of the commercial interest to keep it for themselves and make money out of it. Is it really persistent data? Well, the archives of private companies, how well are these maintained? I'm not really sure about it, I don't really know it, but do they have an interest to keep the data for ages so that we will be able to learn about what went on these days? I don't know. It's not necessarily in their commercial interest. And finally, you have something like the privatization of public communication. The public is situated in the data maintained by private companies. It's publicly relevant for us to have access to this data, to be able to make sense of our times, but maybe we don't have that access. And that's something that Derrida pointed out when talking about the archives. Having hold of or controlling the archives is a question of power, because he who controls the archives, he maintains the access rights, or he can control the access to our public memories. So do I think it's a problem that these kind of memories are privatized? Yes, I do. Then let's look at the public data. The good news is no restrictive licenses. So do we have access to the public records of the parliament, of the government? Usually yes. Well, we don't have it to the NSA, but mostly yes. And I think public data are underestimated and underused so far. There's a lot you can do with parliamentary protocols or the data the government has. And we don't make that much use out of it so far because everybody's doing fancy stuff with Twitter and Facebook. So let's work on that. The bad news is public institutions themselves do not pay a lot of attention to hand over their data in a well-maintained format. You get PDFs, okay, you can work with that, it's difficult. You get very messy text data at times. And I've come across a couple of instances when data are just lost, like press releases of ministries. When a new minister comes into office, the first thing his team will do is to delete the old press messages, press releases, because you don't want people to learn about the success and great things that predecessors did. So it's really gone. And maybe somebody from the IT knows a tar archive where you might find it, but it's very difficult. And then the server is set up anew and it's gone. So we need to rely on ourselves and prepare data for the sake of academia. That's what we tried to do in the Palmine project, which was kind of the label I thought about for what we're doing at the at Duisburg University. What we tried to do is to work with public data, to prepare these in a sustainable fashion, prepare these in a standardized fashion, and to maintain access and quality. How do we do that? First, to make it sustainable, web scraping is easy. You can do very, very hacky things and have quick solutions, but that doesn't mean that the solution is sustainable. I think we need, or having reliable research data means moving beyond web scraping, and that means it's not enough to have a set of tools to scrape the web and turn it in something like XML, but you need really need, I think, frameworks for processing certain types of data. What I'm thinking about is having a framework that puts the code into the driver's seat for preparing plenary protocols, for downloading and preparing press releases of ministries and other kinds of public data that we have. So it's not that easy, but it can be done. Then standardization. XMLification is the first step. The second step, I think, is I would call it typification, using some standard XML format. But at least for the data I work with, we need supplementary data too. And there need to be accompanying databases for parliamentary protocols, for instance. Or, for instance, information about the speakers, the ministers we might have. So there's more than just the pure text that we need, but I think that's something you need to think a lot about. And finally, I'm really a fan of open access data, but still I don't think it should be free for download anywhere in the web, because then we will have the tragedy of public goods. I think that there needs to be a registration process for the data, because newspapers don't give us their data, so I want to make it, it's a matter of reciprocity, that they don't have easy access to our data. And then we need, I think, user communities for the data, so that you have a gradual improvement of the quality. And I'll try to strengthen that case later on. Finally, public data. Maybe some of the private data can be turned into public data through regulations. Maybe that's something we can work for it together. So this is the purpose of the Palmine project. I'd like to talk about the theory and how we try to make sense of what we have as a second step. First, social scientists tend to look at the research process usually from two perspectives. It can be either deductive or inductive. Deductive research designs would mean that you have a theory. No need to explain where the theory comes from. But then you derive hypotheses from the theory, you find an appropriate operationalization, a way to measure your concepts, your hypotheses, and then you can perform an empirical test. And this is the approaches that we have so far in the social sciences and political sciences when people work with large-scale textual data. There's a lot of research about coalition formation, that is, which party will form a coalition with another party. Will the Christian Democrats enter a government with the Social Democrats, or the Greens, or the Liberals? And then you text party manifestos are used in a set of, in a body of research to identify the political positions of parties, and it will become a variable in the broader research process. And this is very deductive, and the original text doesn't matter at all. This is not about meaning. Then we have inductive research designs. And this just proceeds the other way around. You have empirical observations, you read the text, you develop your hypotheses, and then you proceed towards generalizations, starting from the empirical data. You very often have that in case-based research designs, when you look at one specific instance, something that happened. And I think that's what many of you will be doing when you perform your research. The third approach that we can identify, it calls itself, or it's sometimes called abductive research designs. And then you have a different balance between quantification and qualitative work. quantification may serve the purpose to identify patterns, something that will be interesting, but then you will move back to the original data, inspect in a qualitative fashion whether the assumption about what might be going on, the assumption about the hypotheses that might apply, whether they really apply, and then you gradually develop your hypotheses and your theories. Now that's one way to present this kind of research process. You have an increasing abstract formulation of the evolving theory, and you have a set of circles that are performed between deriving hypotheses just by speculation or by looking at quantifications, going back to the empirical material, to the empirical field, having a new idea what kind of general pattern might be there, and then going back to a higher abstract or more abstract level of theory again. So this will be a process where you use quantifications and deductive steps in the research process on one side, and then you go back to the text in our case. Now this has a set of implications, because it means that you don't just run a topic modeling exercise or a classification exercise, but you see, as you go back to the text, you will see a lot of dirt, at least I see a lot of dirt when you actually read again the text. And that has implications, I think, because if you are aware about the errors and the dirt in the data, you need a mechanism for quality improvement. And this is the reason why I think it's important to involve users in the development of the data. And you want the contributions of the users to improve the data, and you need a versioning scheme for the data. So this, I think, practically for maintaining data, this is not a small implication of a research process that is adaptive, as I call it. Now, the theory, or these assumptions that I need to move back and forth between the theory and the hypotheses and the data, I think this also has implications for the research infrastructures that we need. First of all, it needs to be interactive. It doesn't really help if I perform a certain calculation and then 2 days later or 1 hour later I have some result, then my time is running away and I need to make sense of this result one way or the other because I don't have the time to do it. It needs to be quick and interactive, so we need performance for the computers, and we need a certain flexibility. We want to employ a set of tools. Now, the way we proceeded was to go for a programming language that allows for interactivity. We made the choice for R, which is very common in the social sciences. The big other competitor would have been Python, which has this nice interactive prompt, but R has a few advantages. It's great, so great for visualizations, and you have lots of statistical packages at hand, much more, I think, than in Python. Then for performance, you need an indexing engine as a backend. So I'm really impressed to see the difference it makes when you just turn the text into numbers. We use the Corpus Workbench, well, because it's well established, it's a very solid base, and we can interface to the Corpus Workbench from R. And then we have all the flexibility we wish for. There's such a broad set of R packages there for statistical analysis, and it's just there. We don't need to develop it ourselves. Then, more from the practical side, I think the system should be open, portable, usable, and documentation should be good. Well, it's not perfectly open, or it's open, it's available on GitHub. There's github.com/Paulmine, there you'll find our code, or the core of the code base. It's not really perfectly portable. It runs on Linux and Mac OS machines. For Windows, you could run it on a virtual machine, but it's, so it is more. Is it usable? There are so many nice tools with great graphical user interfaces, so I would call this a tool for the reckless, but it's not as bad as you might think. and the documentation. Well, I'm really working on that. Currently, we are with version 0.5, and version 0.6 is properly documented. That's how the architecture works. We have the corpora, need to be transformed into an XML format, can be imported in the corpus management system, the corpus workbench, and then we have R with all the links to the statistical packages that are there, and we interface to the corpus workbench through an R package called RCRP, which is basically a wrapper around the C library that is used or included in the corpus workbench, meaning it's quick, it's really nice. And then the idea is that many people presumably don't want to work with R all the time and having to write that code, even though it's quite flexible. The third layer might be graphical user interfaces. What I really like is shiny web applications, something you can write little tools, for instance, to have a conquer dancer or to drill into collocation networks. But you could also use PHP wrappers or the CPP wrap. So there's a couple of options you have at hand. The core functionality we have is you create partitions at the very outset. That means it's a chunk of the whole corpus. And that was really, really important for me, because if you have parliamentary protocols, you usually want to make distinctions and comparisons between speakers from different parliamentary groups. You want to compare across time. You want to inspect individual speakers. So it's important to be able to look at these individual speakers to have these smaller chunks. That's a partition. Then there's a partition bundle that's just a set of different partitions. And that's where the object-oriented implementation actually begins. Like every function that you can apply for a partition can also be applied to a partition bundle. And then you can do some standard things like dispersion, analyzing the context to calculate collocations or co-occurrences, compare corpora. You can calculate the collocations for all co-occurrences that are there in the corpus. And then we have this export functionality. You can go back to the original text and actually read the text and throw out an HTML file. And you can mail yourself the results or export the results into your browser using some JavaScript library. So that's the basic idea. I won't go through the technical details. And to wrap that up, the basic idea is we have a base package, and it might be extended to a family of packages. We have a package for the analysis that's called PolMineR. And we have a package for corpus preparation that's called CTK. And then you might, or we are developing plugins for specific analytical tasks or specific types of data. For instance, there's a package for working with corpora of parliamentary debates. I've mentioned that the implementation is in an object-oriented style, so that's really the basis for making the whole thing extensible. And we use generic R functions that are well known to any R user, like show summary length, bar plot, to inspect the data. Finally, parallelization helps to be quick, but we don't want to do everything ourselves. There is such a wealth of well-established tools, and we want to make use of that, and so we have a set of interfaces to well-established libraries. You can use the topic modeling libraries written in R, in C, or in Mallet. It would be a very something that is used very often. Now, you may ask, well, he's doing everything himself. What does it have to do with cladding? And that's a very strong point I want to make in this respect. First, giving a few people access on our server would easily overwhelm us. So we have a cooperation with the center at Stuttgart, and we're currently preparing one corpus of parliamentary debates, enriching it with a classification, and we'll make it available through the Clavin Center at Stuttgart. But there's something even much more important, because we could just buy a server. Corpus preparation, there's such a wealth of linguistic methods that we can use to enrich our corpus, like named entity recognition, anapher resolution, and so on and so forth, that will be very, very useful. But that's really, for me, the limit of what I can achieve. Well, I struggled with Stanford NLP, Open NLP, and I know I can do it if I have a lot of time, but actually for me it's more time that I want to invest. So the tools, well, are really difficult to get hold of at times. The latest training data, that's the frontier as a political scientist. So this is how we do. We have developed a proof of concept with a Claude package. And what it basically does is you have a chunk of text that you want to tag. You send it to the Stuttgart server with a web interface, with a post service, post operation, and the server returns, the web service returns the fully annotated text, so you can prepare your corpus very nicely. That's a really, really nice thing, and I think that can only be done by a centralized infrastructure that will take the pains to really run the latest tag as an annotation tools. That's something that really looks nice. I think I want to move to my subject matter now. And I want to proceed in three steps. First, something, an analysis with a lot of statistical beef. So this is why you see it's not beef, it's animals. and the first question I want to ask is, we have an increasing number of parliamentarians with a migration background in parliament all over Europe, but in Germany too. And does it make a difference? Do they represent groups in a distinctive way, or do they become ordinary members of parliament, and it's not discernible any longer whether they have a migration background or not? Now, let's look at the numbers at first. Numbers of parliamentarians with a migration background have increased drastically from 3 in the legislative period between 1994 and 1998 to 37 in the Bundestag that was elected in 2013. So there's a real increase. The colors indicate the parliamentary groups, and the black color, that's the Christian Democratic Union, and red is for the Social Democrats, the Greens, and the Left Party. I mean, these party families, you have them all over Europe, and so you see it's mostly the left, center-left political parties that make up for the political representation of immigrants. Now, this is the data I worked with for this purpose. That's the corpus of parliamentary debates, prepared on the basis of the text documents issued by the German Bundestag. There's also the PDF documents. The cleanest version we have is based on the text documents. It's a total of about 70 million words that can be analyzed. The corpus actually is larger, but there's the kind of ceremonial talk by the president of the Bundestag and all that stuff. So you want to cut it out, you can cut it out. So the thought experiment I wanted to perform is as follows. If you had general and good knowledge what a social democratic, Christian democratic, liberal MP sounds like, what kind of language he uses, would you guess correctly the affiliation to a parliamentary group of a speaker if he didn't know about his or her background, if he didn't know that he is called Aslan or Cemal or, yeah? And if you didn't know that he belongs to a visible minority, would you guess it correctly? Now, I struggled with this kind of question for a while. First, I tried to calculate something like the positions of parliamentarians in a two-dimensional space using text similarity measures or something. I think it's much better to consider it as a classification problem. This kind of thought experiment is something like a classification problem that a person that and you don't know about the party affiliation or the parliamentary group affiliation, will he belong to a group for which you have estimated the model, the classification model, on the other data that is there. And what needs to be done as an implementation is first filter the vocabulary and reduce the whole vocabulary to the semantically relevant words. That's the first step. Second, that's too many dimensions. So I applied something like I used a singular value decomposition taken from latent semantic analysis. Increase the number of dimensions. Third, estimate a model for the classification and then classify all the others for just one group. It's a leave one out classification, the speaker whom you don't know about. I want to rush through this quickly. I'll just look at the bird cloud. This is kind of the semantically relevant vocabulary. It's a few thousand words that we identified by always comparing using T-square tests the speeches of one parliamentary groups to all the other parliamentary groups in one legislative period. And then you have this kind of semantically relevant vocabulary. The second step that needs to be performed is you still have, like, depending on the legislative period, 1,000 to 3,000 words that are statistically significant. That's still too much to estimate a model. So the singular value decomposition is the next step to reduce the number of variables and dimensions to something that can actually be handled by a classification tool. So we needed a term document matrix in a lower dimensional space, and we used singular value decomposition for that. That's taken from a latent semantic analysis, but we didn't do all of that. And finally, we had like 82 to 95, depending on the legislative periods, 82 to 95 factors that went into a linear discriminant analysis. And that was trained using all the speakers minus one, and then the other was estimated. I just want to show you the results. I can go into technical details later on. First of all, do we generally speaking classify speakers correctly? So if everything was absolutely perfect, CDU speakers will always be classified as CDU, CDU speakers. A liberal FNP will always be classified as liberal speakers, and the SPD speakers, and so on and so forth. Now, this conveys the first sense of the quality of the model. Apart from the FDP, this horizontal, or this
diagonal
is not that bad, particularly for the bigger parties, for the CDU, CSU, and the SPD, and for the PDS too, it's quite good actually, with up to close to 90% or 85 to 90%. Second, when you look at the wrong classifications, you actually see it's a matter of political proximity. CDU, CSU, that's the Christian Democrats, and the Liberal Party, when you have long-term classifications, it's between these two parties that used to be or consider themselves as the central right bloc in German politics. And vice versa, for the Green Party and the SPD, that's what you have here, okay, you confuse the Green parties as being members of the SPD. So it tells you something about the political orientations or the political proximity. This wrong classification. That's something nice. So it's the first sign that you might trust this model. Now, what we are really interested in is the success rates to classify the migrant speakers. I hope that everybody can read that. That's the speakers with a migration background, and then you have the visible minority MPs. And I think it's just what you find at the bottom right, what is interesting. It's about 80% of them that are classified correctly. So if the thought experiment had been, if we didn't know about the background of the speaker, would we classify him correctly, given that we know what kind of speech is generally used by social democrats, Christian democrats? It's a very comparable rate to what we see otherwise. It's a high rate, actually, in this matrix. So are they really different? No. We couldn't infer that from the language they use in Parliament. First result. Now, a second thought experiment might be, like, the speakers might be a distinctive group. Like, now, we know that they're part of a social democratic parliamentary group or the Greens, but if there was another parliamentary group, would that improve the model if there was another group? That's hypothetical. And what you see here is, if you say that they are part of a distinct group, the quality of the model reduces. That's a clear sign, again, that they are like typical members of their parliamentary groups. And and that's another approach with, actually, it's about visible minorities. Okay, but the message is quite clear. The quality of the model doesn't improve if we assume there's an extra group, and they are actually typically members, just from this statistical approach, typical members of their parliamentary groups. Okay, it's really dark now. Let me share a few ideas on this. This is what I call a beef up quantitative exercise. It's interesting. I think it's a nice, I thought it was a nice thought experiment, but there's a lot we don't know. What do we actually measure? Okay, I know how I reduce the vocabulary. I have a clear sense of that. But giving an interpretation to the reduced number of variables, that's extremely difficult. If you look at the vocabulary that makes up for a factor, I don't manage to make sense out of that, and I haven't met anybody who would be able to do that. So this is something, actually, I don't really want to suggest as the way forward for our kind of research, just to perform like this statistical kind of operation. It's nice, it meets our intuitions, but still there's something I'm not really satisfied about. I don't really know whether the results are valid. I couldn't say, look at the text, this has gone on, this or that text. So I want to take a second approach, a cool down approach. And I do want to do something very easy and come back to the original question, like, what has gone on with Germany? We see that immigrant IPs are just like ordinary members of their parliamentary groups. What is going on that this is possible? And I want to pursue the hypothesis, it's about diversity and that Germany has embraced diversity. There's two corpora I want to look at. Now, because I'm interested in the long-term trends, this is a corpus of plenary protocols I have prepared based on the PDF documents from the German Bundestag. I think it's possible because they ran the OCR part, so the OCR, and it's not bad what you find in the documents. It's about more than 200 million tokens. The second one is Die Zeit, a major German newspaper that is really scrapable. And that's a 320 million token corpus. Looking at the relative frequencies, just a very blunt frequency count of Vielfalt, integration in multiculti. I chose to include multiculti because it's like the contested concept. Now what you see is that there was lots of talk about integration in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, and then renewed talk about. You see a similar trend towards Vielfalt, but integration, that's odd. And multiculti, okay, that began in the 1980s in the newspaper and inside. Okay, there's something I want to learn. I want to learn more about. When you do that in the Bundestag, the pattern last week is like something like a surprise, and it will not take ages. So this is the leaping forward to the third dimension. Like, and we should pass around this box with red and blue glasses. And as you're doing this, I want to explain what I will try to do now, because something that I recognize has fascinated many people in the humanities is the work with collocation graphs. And admittedly, it was what really struck me when I first was in contact with linguists. It really struck me, like, the use of collocation graphs and the ability to use collocation graphs to learn about the structures of a discourse very quickly. Okay, but when trying to use collocation graphs myself, I actually realized that. I want to show something that is not. This is okay. I wanted to use collocation graphs, but actually, collocation graphs, when you calculate all the collocations in a corpus, are really overwhelming. And you need some procedure to reduce the complexity of the data to make the data really, really useful. And personally, I think I didn't come across a solution that was really satisfactory at the outset. And then we had one meeting at a research center for natural scientists, and they led us into a center using very complicated, expensive 3D goggles, and they were showing off, and they were showing how a fire might be analyzed using a three-dimensional representation, how movements of a liquid might be analyzed using a simulation. Okay, so I thought, this is really, they are showing off, but this is really cool. And I thought that it might be the solution for the collocation graphs, because what happens when you look at a two-dimensional collocation graph is it doesn't make a lot of sense, because you have a lot of intersections of the edges. And this is why you need to reduce the number of the edges in a fashion that I find difficult to achieve in a non-arbitrary fashion. So does everybody have one of these glasses? Not yet? Okay. So I proceed with the technical explanation. What I want to look at with you is the collocation or some collocation graphs of the parliamentary groups in the German Bundestag. And what I did was first calculate all the collocations for one group, then compare the frequencies of these collocations with the collocations in a reference corpus, that is all the other speeches given by parliamentary groups, to filter out all kind of this procedural talk that you would have. So it's like a keynote test for the collocations that occur. That reduces the number. And that makes it handleable. And then I again had to apply a cutoff frequency based on the statistical significance, but it reduced the number, brought down the number to 200 or 300 edges and nodes, approximately. I want to come to the conclusion. The point I wanted to make in this last take was that visualizations may be very useful. I think that the third dimension adds something to our analysis, because our eye is so capable to make distinctions what's in the foreground, what's in the background, and it can reduce the complexity of the structures that we see in a very fascinating manner. So visualizations of that kind may be very useful. And it's fancy. Then I wanted to talk about the temptation to over-quantify. That's the case of the classification exercise I undertook. I thought the thought experiment is there. It makes intuitive sense. But we don't know what is actually going on in the data. And we are not really in a position to make statements about the validity of our findings. So yes, we want to make use of text mining techniques, but I think we shouldn't over quantify. Third, we should adapt methods that are there, but I think we should do it in a very careful way. Many methods come from information retrieval, for instance, but there you have a very, very specific practical task at hand, and is it exactly the task that we have in social science or in literary science? So we need to understand that. And I think the methodological progress need not be very, very fast, but I think we should gradually expand our knowledge, what kind of method it serves, which kind of research purpose best. I think I want to argue that close reading remains or is still important to validate our results. Close reading needs to persist. And finally, I think we still need to work on models for public data that persists. Thank you very much for your attention.